is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. You never change, you never fail, oh God. True are your promises, and true are your promises. True are your promises. You never change, you never fail, oh God. So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. So we song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run.
There's no space.
Oh, there's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on. I am.
Sing that one more time.
I am.
Hope this morning
he shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze is fixed on Jesus' face.
Oh Lord, oh Lord, our God. is the flow. You can be seated this morning.
That makes me white as snow.
Our worship only. Let's sing it in this place.
Oh, at the feet of Jesus.
He's worthy this morning to be worshiped and praised in this place.
His cup alone, my holy grail, and there'll be no other. God's before him, just Jesus.
Couple times I'll worship only,
so I'll worship only at the feet of Jesus, his cup alone, my holy grail.
Wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord.
A wonderful Savior to be.
Let's sing it out right across this room. He hideth my soul.
He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love. Me there with him.
Bibles this morning, I'll be reading from the book of Matthew, chapter 6 and verse 33. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. In our Bibles, it's one of the most powerful sermons in the Bible, and it was the one that Jesus preached on the side of the mountain. It's sometimes referred to as the Sermon on the Mount or the Sermon on the Side of the Mount. But I'm going to read a portion of that sermon that he preached that day in verse 33. But I'm going to go back to verse 31, and it says, "Therefore, do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?'" Now, these are three very important things. But the Bible says, don't worry about what you eat, what you drink, and what you wear. "For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you have need of them all." All very important. The Father knows that we need everything that was mentioned there, and a whole lot more, amen, that we need. Verse 33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you." So the first thing we got to do is to seek. Seek the Lord, seek his righteousness, and all of these other things will be given unto us. There's a lot of seeking going on in the world today. There's seeking peace. We hear it on the news every day. In the world, we're seeking peace in our lives. We're seeking a better life, more finances to meet the needs of our lives. We're seeking an education. But the verse that I just read says, "But seek ye first." All of these things are important, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all of these righteousness shall be added, all of these things shall be added unto you. The title of my message this morning is "The Church and the Gospel." You're sitting in a church here today, and you're hearing the gospel. When church was closed down and there was no church building, you were listening to it on the online, and there were lots of places there that the gospel message was going forth. There was a great evangelist in the 1800s named Dwight L. Moody. He was founder of the Illinois Street Church, now the Moody Church in Chicago. Most of you have probably heard about that, heard about D.L. Moody. The church got started from a Sunday school. That church was built there and started with a few children, and all of a sudden, it was up to 1,000 people were in Sunday school. Some would refer to Pastor Moody, Mr. Moody, as the father of Sunday school. We all remember those days. He was 62 years old when he passed away. And I always thought that was old, 62 years old, that's getting up there. But now I'm looking at it, it's like, that's young for a man to pass away. But he had a great life. And we're celebrating here at Windsor Pentecostal Church our 95th anniversary this year. And at one time during the 60s and 70s, they tell me that the Sunday school here had upwards to 600 on the register, and in attendance on a Sunday school, there was about 450 children. And I run across these children that are one time in the Sunday school, maybe at a hospital bed, maybe in a funeral, but I run across all of the seeds that were sown in Sunday school in this congregation, Windsor Pentecostal Church. D.L. Moody tells the story about his conversion and call into full-time ministry. He's from Northfield, Massachusetts. And his father passed away when he was 5 years old, and he had to quit school in grade 3. That's young for quitting school. He worked on the farm, and he says that he hated farm work. He hated what he was doing, and when he was 18 years old, he decided to go to Boston to work with his uncle in the shoe store. And he went there, and his uncle said, "Well, what kind of job do you want?" He said, "Well, I could be the vice president." He said, "No, you're going to start with the broom." But he said, "There's some guidelines and stipulations for you coming here. I know you're my nephew, but there are guidelines. You can't do this, you can't do that, and every Sunday you have to attend church." Well, he attended church as a boy, but he didn't like that too. But he wanted the job, and he wanted to make a living for himself. So he went to the Sunday school in the church, and he was in a Sunday school class. And the next day, he was back in the store, and he looked out, and he saw Mr. Kimball walking in front and walking once and walking twice, and he's thinking, "What's going on? What's he doing?" And he's out there, and is he speaking to himself? Is he talking to himself? And he came in, and he said to Dwight, he said, "I want you to come out. I need to talk to you. It's private." So they went out in the back of that shoe store there. And there, and this is what Mr. Kimball said to him: "The Lord Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. If you don't ask him to be your Savior, you are going to die in your sins, and you're going to hell." Now, how much plainer can you get than that? And right there in that shoe store, Dwight L. Moody bowed his knee and gave his heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, Moody wanted to be successful. He grew up poor, as where his father died, and worked on a farm, but he wanted to be successful and make a lot of money. So he heard that in Chicago that there was a lot of prosperity, so he made his way to Chicago. When he got to Chicago, he started attending a church there. And in that church, there was something you had to do. You had to pay for your pew. Now, you don't have to do that here today. You don't have to pay for your pew today. This is not a message, an offering message. But he decided to buy 4 pews. So what he did with those 4 pews, he started bringing people in off the street into those pews. And after a while, he was getting the ire of the church leadership, and some of the deacons didn't like what was happening there. They didn't like the smell that was coming in to their church. So what did he do? So Mr. Moody said, "Well, I'm just going to rent a place," and he rented a saloon, and he started to bring kids in off the street into that saloon, and that grew, and that class, Sunday school class, grew, and it grew. But God was speaking to him, and in his ministry, he was reaching a lot of kids for Jesus Christ. But in his professional and business career, he had grown to be the number 2 salesman in the United States. He was making a lot of money. And $100,000 back then is $1 million now. But he was number 2, second only to John Wanamaker. Now, a lot of you probably don't know the name of Wanamaker. But when I heard that name, it was a name that when he became an evangelist and he traveled, this businessman in Philadelphia provided a building that he could come in and have services. And if you're a golfing fan, I know there are a few here this morning, you know what the Wanamaker Trophy is all about, right? Yes, Phil Mickelson won it a couple of weeks ago. Was I ever proud? An older man, 51 years old, older man, the oldest man ever to win a major. One up for Phil. But he wanted to beat John Wanamaker, and he wanted to be really, really successful. But God was speaking to him about full-time ministry. And he remembered a verse from his childhood, and it said, the verse was, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto him." But God was speaking to him. So it was during this time that he was deciding whether to go with full-time ministry or what to do. He decided to go back. He went back to Northfield, Massachusetts. And he thought about a man, which was the verse that he had read. He thought about a man that he would work with in their field. And the man would say to him, "Son, when I was a boy," and he would tell him those stories. But he said, "When I was a boy, I wanted to make a lot of money. I wanted to be really successful in life. So I left home, and before I left home, my mama gave me a Bible. And in the front of that Bible, she wrote John 6 and 33. She underlined the verse, and she wrote it in the front of the Bible. And he took that Bible, and he left home, ready to make a lot of money. And he went to the first town and got a job and got a position, and he went to church because that's where you go if you want to meet people, and he wanted to meet a wife, and so he went to church there. And after four or five Sundays, the pastor got up and he preached a message. My message this morning is on John 6 and 33, John 6 and 33, which was the same one that his mother gave him. "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you." He left and he went to another town. And the first, but during that first town, when the pastor, he gripped the seat and he said, "Lord, not now. I've got too much. I've got too much to do. And not now. I'm not ready to give my heart to the Lord." So he went to the second town and the second church. And the first sermon that was preached was John 6 and 33. John 6 and 33. The same scripture. And the Holy Spirit would grip them, and he gripped his seat. But what he did this time, he left and he ran out of the church and he ran to a gravestone. And he said, "God, I can't right now. I've got too much in life. I can't make a commitment right now." So when he went back, when Dwight Moody went back to Northfield, he said, "Mama, where is that man that worked in the field with us?" And she said, "Dwight, he's in an asylum up in Vermont." He said, "I'm going to go see him." He went up to the asylum and spoke to the management there, the administrator. And he said, "Yeah, no problem." He said, "Nobody comes to see him. He says he don't talk." And he went into that room when he opened the door, and he looked at him, and the man started. And he said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all of these things." And he kept saying it and saying it. And that's all he would say, and he couldn't communicate with him, so he left, went back home, went back to Chicago. And then a few years later, he came back to Northfield again. He said to his mama, "Where is that man?" She said, "Well, he's home now. He's here. He spends most of his days sitting on the porch." He said, "I'm going to go see him." He went down the street and crossed. The guy didn't talk. And he saw him coming. And he said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added on to you." He kept singing it, saying it, but he still couldn't communicate. He went back to Chicago. And his mom said, a few months later, he passed away. But he told little Dwight out in the field that day, you know. He said, that feeling that I got just went away and I never ever felt it again. The Bible says that my spirit will not always strive. You may be watching online today. You may be here and have good intentions. Say, someday I'm going to be saved. Someday. Someday I'm going to give my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. My prayer is that today will be that someday. God uses the church and he uses the gospel. I grew up, I went to Sunday school as a boy, and at the age of 15, around about that age, I said, you know, I've had enough of church, I've had enough of Sunday school, I've had enough of CAs and all of that. I'm going to just experiment with some alcohol and smoking and that. And got away from the Lord. And then at age 17, I went to university. But what I didn't know, there was a prayer team praying for me at BMC, praying for my soul. There for a couple of months, in Elam Church, I made my way to an old-fashioned altar one Sunday evening when Pastor Pauline Shaw was bringing the word. I didn't run out. I didn't say no, although I had said no a few times in church, said, I'm not ready. But that night, I said yes. Pastor Jeff did a series this past Tuesday night, Walking in the Way. I had gotten away from the way, and then I'm back in the way. I just want to encourage you to go into our Facebook page and our YouTube and just view that series. It's a wonderful series, Walking in the Way. Matthew 6 and 33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. D.L. Moody in October the 6th, 1871, in his church that grew from a Sunday school in a YMC hall there, a sports complex, grew to be a great church, and he planted a church. And on October the 6th, 1871, he was in his church preaching on a midweek service, and he read Matthew 27 and 21. Matthew 27 and 21, I'm going to read it. It was about the life of Jesus that he was teaching the series on. And 21 says, Pilate said to them, what then shall I do with Jesus? Pilate said, what then shall I do with Jesus? I ask that same question today. What shall you do with Jesus? We all have to answer that. But that particular night, there was a lot of commotion. And he said, I'm going to close the service early tonight. And 2 days after that, the great Chicago fire that burned a third of Chicago and 300 souls' lives were lost there. He escaped into a boat out into the harbor. And the fire raged for more than 24 hours. And after that, he came back to the charred remains of his church, went up to where the Pope was, and he said, never again will I preach a message and not give an altar call. It haunted them probably the rest of his life. What shall I do with Christ? There's a lot of distractions going on, and that's why he dismissed it. The church, make a note of this today. The church is the messenger, and the gospel is the message. You can tweet that. The church is the messenger, and the gospel is the message. We, the people, are the church. This group of body of people in this building, in this church building today, we are the church. We are the messengers. We are the ones that are going out and witnessing and telling others about the Lord Jesus Christ. And the message is the gospel. David Maines on 100 Huntley Street would say often, The church is God's address here on earth. This building right here, King Street, is God's address here on earth. We in our homes are God's address here on earth. We're not perfect, but there's a purpose in this church. There's a purpose for this building. There's a purpose that we come here, we worship, we teach, we warn, we correct, and we care for each other, and we bear one another's needs. The Bible says the enemy, the devil, came to steal, to kill, and destroy. And you know what he also came to do? He came to distract, and he came to make us complacent. The dictionary meaning of complacent says, I'm pleased with one situation without the awareness of some potential danger. There's that danger of being complacent in where we are. There's a danger in being complacent where we are in the COVID world that we've been living in for the last over a year. And thank God things are starting to free up and starting to get better. But you know what? There's still danger. My word, my warning to you today is don't be complacent and don't be distracted. Stay focused. The worship team is coming at this time. Coming back. The gospel is the message. The church and the gospel. What is the gospel? Some people listening to me today, maybe the first time you've ever viewed online, and you're thinking, what is the gospel? And Paul wrote to the Roman church, and he had never been there, but he outlined what the gospel is, the simple gospel, and I'm going to give it to you this morning, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's not one that's without sin in this place or ever on earth, only Jesus Christ. So what? We are all sinners. And then he wrote in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. I'm offering you a gift today, a gift of God. When the Bible says the wages of sin is death, it's not meaning just going down in the ground. The meaning of death there is eternal separation from an almighty God. I've sat by the bedside of young people, older people, and they refused prayer. They refused to acknowledge Jesus Christ. And to my knowledge, they died without never knowing. Maybe they said no until the Spirit of God is always there if you call out. But maybe that feeling and that desire, like that man, left him. Maybe he said no too many times. Maybe you're going through a sickness. I intend to get saved. Doctor says I got a few more months, or could be a year. I'm going to make that decision someday. Someday. That someday may never come. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's the gospel message. Christ died on the cross for our sins. And then he said in Romans 10:9, if you're writing these verses down, you can go in and read them again. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. I'm going to always give you an opportunity. Those that are watching, those that are here today. You know, the doctor may say we've got a few more months. But I am expecting the return of Christ, the rapture of the church, any day. Any day. Is there anything that's not fulfilled? Everything has been fulfilled. The world stage is now set. I read the Jerusalem Post this morning, and everything is in such a political unrest there, and they've come together with a coalition to get rid of the prime minister there. And they've made coalition agreements with others there that do not believe as they believed. We've got a one world currency. It's all in place. Check it off. Buy and sell with a microchip. Revelations 13 and 7. Check it off. The battle of Gog and Magog in Ezekiel 38 and 39, when all of the nations of the earth come against Israel, it's unfolding every day. And we saw it in the war. I think it was 11-day war that they had with Hamas just a few weeks ago. That's not going away. They proved that the dome, the Iron Dome around Israel, did not get all of the missiles. There were over 4,000 missiles fired, but there are thousands aimed at Israel. From Syria, Lebanon, the Gaza Strip, all aimed at Israel. Iran says they want to erase Israel from the map. So the Gog and Magog war, which will take place before the Great Tribulation. Who knows? One world leader, the Antichrist, Revelations 13 and 2 Thessalonians 2 and 3 in the Bible. We're waiting for the announcement before the rapture and the church is gone, then the Antichrist. People are going to think he's the Christ, but he's the Antichrist. So I'm going to pray a prayer today. It's called the Salvation Prayer. I was thinking that, and I see Ryan back there, and Ryan is on the search and rescue team here in Grand Falls, Windsor. And he got called out, and there was somebody in the water. Chief McKenzie was there, and they said, now we're going to throw out a lifeline. All you got to do is catch a hold of it. And you say, no, I don't want a lifeline. I'm okay, I can swim. And all of a sudden, you go down. I'm throwing a lifeline to you today. I'm giving you an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. We're going to sing, after I pray this prayer, Living Hope. And a part of the words of that song says, in desperation, I turn to heaven. In desperation, I turn to heaven. Folks, you may not be desperate, but this is a good day to turn to heaven. Amen? Are you praying with me? Because I'm going to pray the prayer. And it could be your son or your daughter or your grandchild, your mom and her dad that may be listening, maybe not now, but sometime, maybe this week or in the future, that's going to say, I want that. I've said no long enough. I need what they have. As I pray this prayer, there's nothing magic about the prayer. And it's not like it got to be certain words or anything, but I'll lead you in a prayer. But if you just say, you know, God, forgive me of my sins. Jesus, I accept you as Savior. As a Savior is a lifeline. I accept you as Savior. That's all it takes. Confess the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm going to pray that prayer right now. I want you to bow with me in prayer. Dear Father God, I come to you today with all of my sins, with all of my hurts, with all of my fears, and I ask you, Father God, to forgive me of my sins. I ask you, Jesus, to be my Savior and come into my heart. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my heart. Amen. Amen. Those that have prayed that prayer today, we have resources here at the church. Call the church. Let somebody know that I made that decision today to serve Jesus. Call us. Call myself. Call one of the pastors. Today is also Communion Sunday. And that's a special time of the month. We celebrate communion the first Sunday in each month. And we're going to do that today. Is there anybody that don't have their communion? The ushers, we have extras back there. If there's anybody, could you just lift your hand if there's somebody that don't have communion today? Okay, one back here. Anybody else? At home, if you don't have the communion cup like we have, go get some juice and crackers. And you can participate along with me today. The only requirement taking the communion is knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And there may be you that have done that today and you gave to your heart. Go get some crackers. Go get some juice. Have communion maybe for the first time in your life today. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. The Bible says in Corinthians, it says, let a man or a woman or a person examine themselves. Yeah, I examine myself right now. Lord, forgive me for the times that I didn't act Christ-like. Forgive me, Lord. We're all human. Examine ourselves. Say, God, forgive me. Forgive me. The word says in 1 Corinthians 11 and 23, for I received of the Lord that which I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. Take your bread. Could you open that for me, Pastor Andy? Take bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He broke it and said, this do in remembrance of me. Let's partake together. Thank you, Jesus. The body of Christ. Lord, touch some person, Lord, that's sick in body, Lord, right now in this place right here. You bore the stripes for our healing, Lord, and we claim that healing, Father, right now in the name of Jesus. I believe God is healing somebody right now in this place. Those that are watching online, I feel his presence. There's an anointing in this place this morning. There's an anointing here. There's a healing anointing. That's right, just receive. Receive your healing, because Jesus suffered in his body for each one of us. All of those prayer requests today, he suffered. And the Bible says, in the same manner, he also took the cup, and after supper, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant of my blood. This do as often as you do it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Let's partake together. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the blood that you shed. Lord, I pray, Father, right now, that if there's one listening, God, there's another opportunity to give you life to Christ today. Just say, God, forgive me of my sins, Jesus, come into my heart. He shed his blood for you. Let's all stand as we sing Living Hope.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost his grip on me.